إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعين ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره المشركون. قال الله عز وجل: يا أيها الذين آمنوا إن من أزواجكم وأولادكم عدوا لكم فاحذروهم، وإن تعفوا وتصفحوا وتغفروا فإن الله غفور رحيم. فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى: ولا تستوي الحسنة ولا السيئة، ادفع بالتي هي أحسن، فإذا الذي بينك وبينه عداوة كأنه ولي حميم. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: أثقل الشيء على الميزان بعد تقوى الله عز وجل الحسن الحلو. جماعة المسلمين، the khutbah today is concentrated inshallah in three parts. The first is the quality of maghfirah, and the second one is to look at the hukum of the attendance of the funeral of a non-Muslim, and thirdly to look at, you know, the way we must spend our times during the holidays inshallah ta'ala. Allah ta'ala says in the glorious Quran: ya ayyuha alladhina amanu inna min azwajikum wa awladikum aduwwan lakum fahdharuhum. O people of Iman, inna min azwajikum, verily from your wives and your children, aduwwan lakum, they sometimes act as enemies towards you. فَحْذَرُوهُمْ, so be careful. وَإِن تَعْفُوا, but if you have pardon, وَتَصْفَحُوا, وَتَغْفِرُوا, and you are lenient towards them, وَتَغْفِرُوا, and you forgive, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورُ رَحِيمٌ, then verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is غَفُورٌ. Allah is غَفُورٌ, which means Allah ta'ala grant you maghfirah, forgiveness. رحيم, merciful. And then Allah Ta'ala also says, وَلَا تَسْتَوِ الْحَسَنَ وَلَا السَّيِّئَةِ, that verily the hasana and the sayya, the doing of good and the doing of an evil deed, it is not the same. It don't have the same effect. اِدْفَعْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنَ, so therefore repel the bad deed with a good deed, with something that is better. فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَةٌ, because verily by doing that, then if there's enmity between you and another person, كَأَنَّهُ وَلِيٌّ حَمِيمٌ, that person who was your enemy, because you are treating him or her well, you don't respond in the same way, then Allah Ta'ala says, كَأَنَّهُ وَلِيٌّ حَمِيمٌ, that person can become your closest of friends just by not retaliating, by giving afu, by giving pardon and maghfirah. Allah Ta'ala, you know, can grant an enemy to become a close friend. وَقَالَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَثْقَلُ الشَّيْءَ عَلَى الْمِيزَانِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, that the act that is the weight, the heaviest on the scales on the day of Qiyamah, after the quality of taqwa Allah, is husnul khuluq, is to have good manners, to have good akhlaq. And you know, it is a fact that, you know, that the first president of the Democratic South Africa, Nelson Mandela, that he had, you know, good akhlaq, that is ways and manners of dealing with people has become almost legendary amongst, you know, South Africans and amongst people, you know, all over the world. And so what we must also realize is that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will always be our role model and our example. There was, you know, there's so many interesting stories. And the story that we would like to relate to you is where a Bedouin came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he started choking the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he choked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because he felt that he did not receive enough ghanima from the spoils of war. He did not, his share was too little. And obviously the Sahaba was, they were extremely upset with the behavior of this Bedouin. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went home and he went to fetch from his ghanima, from his spoils of the war, and he came in and he gave this Bedouin, and he said to the Bedouin, you know, are you now satisfied? Are you happy with the way I'm treating you now? And the Bedouin was happy, and he said to the Bedouin, the only thing that I want is that you go in public in front of the Sahaba and you inform them that I have treated you well, because I do not want them to have any animosity in their hearts towards you, because the last action that you perform, that is what they have seen, so they have a bad feeling towards you. So go in, out in front of them, and I will ask you, have I treated you well? And then you respond. So Rasulullah ﷺ was very conscious of the fact that he wanted people to have a good heart towards one another. And today, you know, it is a fact that sometimes in terms of our religion, we have very little tolerance towards one another. Sometimes if people just do slightly different things in their ibadah, then we develop an animosity towards them. And this is not the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes people maybe put their hands on the chest, and we put our hands on our navels, and then we, you know, we develop a certain degree of animosity. You know, sometimes people, they make salah, and they only raise their hands at the beginning of the salah. And others maybe raise their hands when they go into ruku, out of ruku, and when they come into the third rak'ah. But these things are documented that in certain areas of the world, it is a cause of conflict, and it's petty things. So, you know, we must have greater tolerance, greater maghfirah, and the ayah that I've mentioned of your wife and the children, that you must have maghfirah. You know, speak with kindness towards him. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, he was playing with his grandchildren at home, and one of the Sahaba, one of the people of Medina, he came into the home of Umar, and the grandchildren was riding on the back of Umar, and he was extremely surprised that here's the Amir and he has a soft nature towards his grandchildren, thinking that the Amir must be very stern, very, you know, strong-hearted, shouldn't be have that kind of leniency in his heart towards kids. And Sayyidina Umar asked him, you know, how are you with your family? And he said that, you know, when I come in, nobody talks. They only talk once I have given their permission. And so you find the picture of a person that has this, you know, idea that he's the sultan in the house, and nobody can oppose him, nobody can say anything, only after he has given permission. So he's really treating his wife and his children like nothing. So Sayyidina Umar said to him, إِذَا لَمْ تَكُنْ رَحِيمًا بِأَهْلِ بَيْتِكَ, if you don't have rahmah towards your Ahli Baytik, towards your children, you know, towards your family, فَلَنْ تَكُنْ رَحِيمًا بِأُمَّةِ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ, then you will not have true mercy and rahmah towards the ummah of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So there's lots of stories you know, about Nelson Mandela that have passed away, and how he has, you know, forgiven people, and especially seeing that he has suffered for 27 years in prison. And the only reason why we are mentioning this today is that if we don't have that kind of character as Muslims, and we have the Quran, and we have the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then we must be ashamed of ourselves. That, you know, that a person that do not have Iman, that do not have the Quran, have a character that we, you know, cannot live by. And really, we should actually be the examples. We have another good example of Hassan, and it could be the grandson of Rasulullah ﷺ, or Hassan al-Basri, where his servant came with the water of wudu, and it fell upon him. You know, the vessel broke, and the water of wudu fell on his head, and all over his body, and he was extremely upset. And, you know, the servant recited verses of the Quran that Allah Ta'ala forgives you and Allah Ta'ala pardons you, and he says, I immediately, you know, pardon you for the sake of Allah and I grant you maghfirah. And when he recited Wallahu yuhibbul muhsineen, he says, I will set you free for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the akhlaq of a Muslim. So, you know, sometimes we must question ourselves, how do we handle our children? Are we forgiving? How do we handle our wives? You know, how do we handle our workers? You know, do we just want to have a bossy attitude, or do we have some kind of leniency towards them, as the Quran wants from us in certain conditions? So, Jamaatul Muslimin, this is the first point that I would like to highlight to the Jamaat. Secondly, you know, people always ask the question, whether they should attend the funeral of non-Muslims. And obviously, with the passing away of Madiba, people are also going to know whether one must go or whether you shouldn't go. And, you know, so I would like to spend some time, inshallah, to handle this particular mas'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the glorious Quran, بَعْدَ أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ إن الذين كفروا وماتوا وهم كفار أولئك عليهم لعنة الله والملائكة والناس أجمعين خالدين فيها لا يخفف عنهم العذاب ولا هم ينذرون. Really, those people who reject Iman, وماتوا, and they died, وَهُمْ كُفَّارٌ, while they were rejecting Allah Ta'ala and His Messenger, they rejected Islam. In other words, أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ. This is Allah Ta'ala's kalam in the Quran, that even the good neighbor of your good neighbor next door, you know, even Mother Teresa, even Nelson Mandela, all of them, even if they were good Christians, this is what Allah Ta'ala says about people who have rejected Iman. Because we judge people on the zahir, that he never in the public accepted Islam. People are going to be very passionate and probably have more anger towards me, you know, than the thing is, Jamaatul Muslimin, Allah Ta'ala says about your good neighbor, that good person that, you know, 2 o'clock in the morning, your Muslim neighbor will not actually open his door, but they will say, okay, you need a car to take your wife to hospital, somebody gets sick, I will take you. But that good person, you know, even if they have done the world of good, Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ وَالْمَلَائِكَ وَالنَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا, that they will stay in that condition, in the akhirah. لا يخفف عنهم العذاب. Allah Ta'ala says the azab will not be made lighter for them. ولا هم ينذرون, nor will they be given respite. So they won't have a day that they will have a holiday from azab. Every single day, you know, there will be no takhfif. Even if they plead to the malaika, even if they make tasbih, as mentioned in the hadith that Ibn Rajab mentions in the sifat of the Ahl al-Nar, he says that if people say for 1,000 years, Ya Hannan, Ya Mannan, you know, you're appealing to Allah, the one that is, you know, that forgives, the one that overlooks, you know, that is kind, that even if you recite the names of Allah 1,000 years, your adab will not be lessened. So this is that what awaits a person that is a non-Muslim. And therefore one should not have sweaters with Mandela's face on it, because that is ta'zim. You are granting ta'zim to a person that Allah Ta'ala, you know, says in the next life, la'natullah alayh. You cannot carry, even with soccer stars, soccer players, you cannot walk around with Rooney's photo on your back on the t-shirt. Same with Mandela. You admire him for certain things and that's it. But your role model will still be Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَمَاتُوا وَهُمْ كُفَّارُ. Allah says in Surah, that was in Surah Baqarah, in Surah Al Imran, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَمَاتُوا وَهُمْ كُفَّارٌ فَلَنْ يُقَبَلَ مِنْ أَحَدِي مِلْءُ الْأَرْضِ ذَهَبًا وَلَوْ افْتَدَى بِهِ. Allah says that the people who have rejected Allah and they died, وَهُمْ كُفَّارٌ, and they are disbelievers, فَلَنْ يُقَبَلَ مِنْ أَحَدِهِمْ مِلْءُ الْأَرْضِ ذَهَبًا. That even if the entire earth was converted to gold, and they give all of that sadaqah in order to set them free from the fire of Jahannam. Remember Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, ittaqun nar walau bi shikki tamra. That save yourself from the fire even if it's given by giving half a date in charity. So sadaqah has got great power to save you from the fire of Jahannam if it is given in your lifetime. But after you have passed away and you have rejected faith, you have rejected iman, even if your family then gives in your name all the gold of the world to set you free from the Jahannam, it will be of no avail. أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Allah says those people will have a painful punishment. وَمَا لَهُمْ مِنْ نَاصِرِينَ. And they will have no one to help them. So Jama'at al-Muslimin, if after your death person is non-Muslim, no amount of sadaqah, all the flowers, you know, that they put, you know, to in honor of Madiba, all of that money, even the 72 million that they spend on buses and for the stadium, for his memorial days in the Western Cape, 72 million. If all of that was spent to save him from the fire of Jahannam, it will not be enough. So one cannot, you know, change your Facebook status and put his photos on there, because he don't have izzah in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ما كان للنبي الذين آمنوا استغفروا للمشركين ولو كانوا أولو قربى من بعد ما تبين لهم أنهم أصحاب الجحيم. Allah Ta'ala says in Surah Tawbah that it is not fitting for the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he must seek maghfirah for the mushrikeen, even if they are family, after it has been made clear to them, that person is of the Ashabul Jahim. So Rasulullah ﷺ had an uncle, not an ordinary person. That uncle looked after Rasulullah ﷺ. He looked after him for years. You know, we know his father passed away before he was born. His grandfather passed away at the age of 8. So his uncle looked after him for his entire youth from the age of 80. And this person, Abu Talib, when he passed away, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not allowed to even ask Allah Ta'ala for maghfirah for his uncle. So we cannot say we must be politically correct, because I mean that was a person that was very dear to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He wasn't an ordinary person. He was uncle, but he was almost like a father to him. He raised him. He looked after him. He provided for him. But he was not allowed to attend to make maghfirah for him. Jama'atul Muslimin, Allah Ta'ala also says, وَلَا تُصَلِّ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ مِّنْهُمْ مَاتَ أَبَدًا. And do not perform salah over him. Allah Ta'ala says, وَلَا تَكُمْ عَلَىٰ قَبْرِهِ. And do not stand by his cover and make maghfirah for him. إِنَّهُمْ كَفَرُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. That because they rejected Allah and His Messenger, وَمَاتُوا وَهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. This ayah also in Surah Tawbah is a reference to Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, the chief of the Munafiqeen in Medina. So again, it wasn't an ordinary person. He was the chief. I'm sure if Rasulullah had to go to that janazah, people would think, you know, maybe many of the munafiqeen, many of Ubay's followers would maybe be attracted towards Islam. But Allah Ta'ala gave the verdict, you should not stand at his qabr. You should not perform salatul janazah upon him. So these were two influential people in the life of Rasulullah ﷺ, but he was not allowed to attend the whole funeral procession of his uncle Abu Talib, and even of the Sayyid or the leader of the Munafiqeen in Medina. Remember, he was regarded as one of the leaders of Medina before the arrival of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he was an extraordinary person, an important personality, but Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not go. And Ali radiyallahu anhu qal, قلت للنبي, this hadith is the Musnad of Abu Dawood. He says, قلت للنبي إن أمك شيخ ضال قد مات. This is Sayyidina Ali. He speaks of his father Abu Talib, and he says to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إن أمك, verily your uncle, a shaykh, the old person, a ضال, that is astray, قد مات. You know, you already, that you can see from the wording that he already had some distance between him and his father. Why? Because the father was a mushrik. So the Prophet ﷺ said, اذهب فواري أباك. Go and bury your father. So we have clear evidence from the Sunnah that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not go to bury his uncle Abu Talib. And he asked Sayyidina Ali, the son of Abu Talib, to go and to bury his father Abu Talib. So Jama'atul Muslimin, we have various opinions among the scholars, you know, as regard the permissibility of attending funeral processions of the non-Muslim, and the majority of scholars, you know, say that it is not permissible. And even if you sit at the back of the church, you know, and you don't take part in the ceremony, they would still not allow it, seeing that you are witnessing zur, you are witnessing evil. And Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran of the Ibadur Rahman, وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَشْهَدُونَ الزُّورِ, that those, the qualities of the Ibadur Rahman, that they do not witness zur, they do not witness where people pray to three gods besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Jama'atul Muslimin, we do find that some madahib make permissible for you to go, and they would say it is makruh, and they make it permissible on condition that you avoid praying to Allah Ta'ala to ask for that person to rest in peace or to grant him maghfirah. All of that is forbidden because you're not allowed to ask maghfirah. So Jamaatul Muslimin, just want to mention a few things here that I find quite interesting. An Abi Wa'il qala matat ummi wa hiya nasraniyyah fa'ataytu Umar fa'dhakartu lahu dhalika lahu فقال اركب دابه وسر امامها. That Abu Wa'il, he says, my mother passed away and she was a Nasrani, a person that was a Christian. فأتيت عمر, I came to Umar and I asked him, I mentioned this to him, and he said, اركب دابه, get on your horse, on your riding animal, فسر امامها, and then you proceed of in front of the janazah. Don't be at the back as the Nasara would do, but go in front of it. And we also find Jamaatul Muslimin, an Ata ibn Sa'ib qala matat ummu rajulin min thaqifin wa hiya nasraniyyah fasa'ala ibn Mughaffal faqala inni uhibbu an akhduraha wa la attabi'uha faqala irkab dabah wa sur amamaha alawatan فَإِنَّكَ إِذَا سِرْتَ أَمَامَهَا فَلَسْتَ مَعَهَا. So Abdullah ibn Mughaffal, one of the Sahaba, a person said that his mother died and she was of the Thaqif tribe of Ta'if, and she was a Christian, and he says, I would like to attend and I did not go. He says, so he asked him, he said, can I go? He says, get on your horse and walk in front of the procession. فَإِنَّكَ إِذَا سِرْتَ أَمَامَهَا. So if you are ahead of the procession, فَلَسْتَ مَعَهَا, then you will not be regarded as being part of the procession. وَعَنْ سَعِيدِ بْنُ جُبَيْرٍ قَالَ مَاتَ رَجُلٌ نَصْرَانِيٌّ وَلَهُ إِبْنٌ مُسْلِمٌ فَلَمْ يَتَّبِعْهُ فَقَالَ إِبْنُ عَبَّاسٍ كَانَ يَنْبَغِي لَهُ أَنْ يَتَّبِعُهُ وَيَدْفَنُهُ وَيَسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُ فِي حَيَاتِهِ. So Sa'id ibn Zubayr, one of the students of Abdullah ibn Abbas, he says that a person that was a Nasrani, he passed away, and his son was a Muslim, and he did not follow the janazah, and ibn Abbas said that it was allowed for him to go and to bury his father, and he should have asked only in his lifetime forgiveness for him. But Jamaatul Muslimin, you know, sometimes I think when it comes to family, then one can see that some of the scholars would perhaps lean towards the permissibility of family members to attend, because you know Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, he had a strong stance towards his father, who said that he want to prevent Rasulullah from coming to Medina. He said, today we will stop the people that are low. He will stop them from coming to Medina. And he took out his sword and he says that I will not allow my father to come into Medina until, he says, Rasulullah a'azzu wa ana adhallu. He says, I will not allow my father to step into Medina until he recognizes that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the one that is honored and I am the person that is disgraced. So this man had enmity towards his father, but yet when he passed away, that emotional aspect is there. He asked Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for the jubba of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to bury his father with. You know, he was overcome with emotion. That's human. That was his father, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave the jubba of Rasulullah's personal jubba to Abdullah, so that he can bury his father with that jubba. So Rasulullah did not make dua for him, he didn't attend the janazah, but he recognizes that family members, they have an emotional attachment. You know, that sometimes, you know, if they go, you know, that they would do more harm for their family, their sisters, their brothers that are non-Muslim, in the long run, than them staying totally away from the proceedings. Jazakallah khair. The last thing that I want to mention, Jamaat, is the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It says, "Na'matani maghbunun indahuma kathiru minan nas, is two favors of Allah that many people neglect, and that is sihha, your health, and faragh, your free time. Jamaatul Muslimin, we are in the time of holidays for many of us. This is the time that we must sit in the masjid. You know, during the year people have excuse, they have to study, they have to do this, they have to go back to work. They're always busy. But now it's holidays. You're not going to go to beach every single day. You're not going to go on camp for every single day. If you have 3 weeks holiday, maybe for a week, you have 2 weeks to really come closer to Allah. But we still find people, they don't have time to make dhikr, they don't have time to make the sunnah salah, which is an indication that the akhirah means less to us than, you know, than our dunya. We have the free time, but we waste. The salah is the first thing that we will be questioned. أَوَّلُ مَا يُحَاسَبُ بِهِ الْعَبْدِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ الصَّلَاةِ فَمَنْ صَلُحَتْ صَلُحَ سَائِرُ عَمَلِ. That if that is successful, then all your deeds will be successful. The first thing that's priority on the day of Qiyamah is salah. For many of us, that is the last on our list of priorities. So may Allah Ta'ala grant us tawfiq to spend our holidays in the proper manner, attend tilawat of Quran, attend majalis with dhikr, you know, to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if we're not going to do it now, when are we going to come and utilize the time to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين من كل ذنب فاستغفروا إنه هو التواب الرحيم.